Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 31st meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Before we begin, can I remind those committee members using electronic devices to please turn them to silent. Our first item of business is a roundtable session on the Hunting with Dogs Scotland Bill. As a roundtable discussion, the format will be a bit different from our usual evidence session, with the purpose to hear as wide a range of views at the same time. We have five or six questions or topics to explore with you. I intend to give about 15 minutes per topic, but I would imagine is that the conversation develops some of the topics that might be covered as part of the conversation. But if we could keep questions and answers as succinct as possible, just to give everybody the maximum opportunity to contribute. And don't feel you have to contribute on every topic if you don't have a particular line or something that's significantly different from the opinions we've already heard. Can I also remind everybody that this session is specifically on rough shooting and not necessarily just about the two dog limit in isolation. We felt as a committee that the rest of the bill was quite clear what the objective of the legislation was. However, we had significant numbers of people raise concerns about rough shooting, and that's why we're having these sessions, so we could try and keep the conversation and the debate around the rough shooting specifically. Before we go into our discussions, I thought it would be a good idea to have a quick round table to introduce each other. So if you could give your name and your organisation and our constituency and region, and if we keep it at that, we'll get fired into the questions nice and quickly. So I'm Fernley Carson, I'm the convener of the committee. I'm also the constituency MSP for Galloway and West Dumfries.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Ross Ewing. I'm the Director of Moorland at Scottish Land and Estates.
Beatrice Wishart, MSP for Shetland.
And I'm Robbie Marsland. I'm the Director of the League Against Cruel Sports in Scotland.
I'm Jim Fairley, MSP for Perthshire South and Kinross.
Good morning. I'm Billy Telford. I'm the Wildlife Crime Coordinator for Police Scotland.
Rachel Hamilton, MSP for Ettrick, Roxburgh and Berwickshire.
Good morning, MSP. Oh, sorry, Jenny Minto, MSP for Argyll and Bute.
Good morning. I'm Alex Hogg, and I'm chairman of the Scottish Gamekeepers Association, and I'm also a gamekeeper working at the present moment in time. I've been working for 40 years.
I'm Ariane Burgess, MSP for the Highlands and Islands.
Good morning. Jake Swindles, Director for the Scottish Countryside Alliance.
Good morning, Cadden Adam, MSP for Bampshire and Buchan Coast.
Good morning, I'm Kirsty Jenkins, I'm Policy Officer for One Kind.
Morning, Alistair Allen, MSP for Nihilin and Anir.
Good morning, Peter Clark, Public Affairs Manager for British Association for Shooting Conservation.
Good morning, I'm Mercedes Vialba, I'm from the Labour Party, I'm a List MSP for the North East Scotland region.
And lastly, but not least, join us remotely.
Mike Flynn, Chief Superintendent of the Scottish SPCA.
Thank you. You're all very welcome. So we'll kick off with the first question. So I would like the panel to give us their opinion of what the meaning of rough shooting is. Nice and simple to start. And I'll start, am I right, Ross?
Thank you, convener. I think I would say there's broadly three things that define what rough shooting is. So the first is that you would typically have a mixed quarry being shot. And what I mean by that is that, you know, generally you'll have a mix of game birds such as pheasant, partridge, woodcock. But you may also have wild mammals, and that's sometimes termed as ground game. So those are kind of the two, I suppose, types of quarry that you might expect to encounter on a rough shoot. I'd also say, you know, one other thing that kind of generally characterises rough shooting is that you usually have a gun or guns walking up terrain to try and flush the quarry. And the quarry can be kind of flushed, I would say, in broadly two ways, either using dogs or sometimes indeed people, you know, a bird will get up in front of you. I think the one thing I'd add, convener, if I may, is that, you know, rough shooting is not necessarily about controlling wildlife. And we've heard that a lot in previous evidence sessions. You know, it's very much something that's done to harvest food predominantly, and it's very much done with a kind of one for the pot ethos. And I think it's very important to get that across, that it's not generally about the management of wildlife. I'll say I partake in a rough shoot. I shoot 10 times a year on a rough shoot in Mr. Fairley's constituency, and I have to say that you know, it's something that generally people get a lot of enjoyment out of. It's a very social occasion, but yeah, broadly characterised by the three things I set out there, convener.
And I'd like to add, Peter.
Echo what Ross has said there. I'd say it's obviously mixed quarry taking place across countryside. I'd just like to make the specific point that during a rough shoot, there is no chasing or killing of the wild mammals with a dog. It's purely flushing. And I would say it's a very humane way of wildlife management as well. I'd also just like to add that, as Ross also said, it's an important activity in terms of providing for the pot, and you know, this is particularly true as regards to food miles, and you know, it's a very ethical way of providing food for the pot.
Alistair.
Thank you, convener. So just, I wonder if you could elaborate, either of you or any of you, a bit on what you've said there. Is it more normal from what you've just said for quarry to be walked up? What proportion of rough shoots actually involve people walking up quarry rather than dogs?
So I've never been on a rough shoot. But that's not been the case. It's always been a case that you have guns kind of walking as part of a line. And it can be, you know, I would say the most simple, the minimalistic form of rough shooting that you could have is literally one person walking with their dogs, you know, just walking up some terrain. But you can, and if I use my shoot as an example, you know, there's about 8 guns, usually. 3 or 4 of us have dogs, and we walk in a line through terrain to try, with exactly what Peter said, the definition, you're trying to flush the quarry, which will then be shot. Now, what I'd say as well, you know, my shoot in Perthshire, ground game, so wild mammals are usually on. You know, we do shoot wild mammals, and we do that for 2 reasons. One, you know, the hare in particular is very tasty and I quite enjoy eating it. But secondly, you know, there is evidence sometimes that the hares are doing damage to regenerative woodland, for example, and there is sometimes a need to kind of, you know, make sure that we're maintaining the populations of hares as well. But the one, it is always characterised, I would say, Mr. Allen, by having a gun in a line or just a gun on its own walking up some terrain.
Jake Swindles. Eloquently put by Ross with the description of the rough shoot, and Ross said that it's not just about controlling wildlife. Whilst I completely agree with that, there is an element of wildlife control in this as well. Many of the rough shoots are what they say, they're rough, over rough ground, rough terrain that you normally wouldn't be able to control and successfully with LAMP or otherwise. So there is an element of being able to walk through rough ground using dogs to flush, to control certain species such as rabbits or hares that would be causing damage as well. So there is a slight element to that.
Can I excuse me, bring in Police Scotland here? Are you clear on what rough shooting is? And do you think, given this bill is all about clarity, are you confident that you won't have to make a decision based on your own opinion to decide whether a crime has been committed or not? Are you comfortable with the current definition of rough shooting?
I've had to do some research into rough shooting. It's not something I have much experience of. I just think that there may be some challenges and confusion if there is, you know, alleged or suspected criminality. You know, essentially, if there's more dogs than 2, and I'm not saying this is right or wrong, if there's more dogs than 2, it's potentially creating confusion and difficulty establishing which dogs have been involved in which act and who has control of which dogs. So I think there is potentially an opportunity for those minority of people that are undertaking illegal acts, you know, kind of illegal fox hunting or so forth, with multiple dogs to claim, falsely claim, that they were rough shooting.
Yeah, because I think there's certainly an issue about forming a pack. That was one of the descriptions that we heard last week from the bill team. Can you set out what your opinion would be of forming the pack?
I think that's where it's going to come down to opinion, and you know, there's obviously the definition. you know, the dictionary definition, but that's not necessarily in real-life terms always going to be totally relevant, I don't think. That's ultimately probably going to come down to the judgment of looking at the evidence, judgment, the opinion, and, you know, speaking to experts. And ultimately, if there was somebody was charged for it, that's something that's going to have to be tested at court. But there is potentially always going to be that, is it or isn't it?
We come to Jake, then Jim, and then Robbie.
Being an ex-police officer, I completely understand what DS Telford is talking about, and I understand the complications that you face when it comes to rough shooting. A couple of concerns I have is, first of all, if this bill goes through as it is, then it would be very easy, I would suggest very commonplace, for people who are against shooting in principle or the killing of animals to be able to disrupt a perfectly legal day. And I think that we will see this commonplace. So, for instance, if it wasn't clear what was going on with in a wood, then an allegation may be made. The police would then be duty-bound to investigate this, which would mean probably most generally stopping a legitimate and lawful activity from going on, which has a knock-on effect because it would stop the wildlife management from taking place, and it would stop a legitimate and legal activity from taking place as well. So that's my first point. I'd seek clarification on. The second point would be the confusion. And I know the Bill team alluded to a rough shoot being used as a loophole. I'd like to dig into that, because generally, if you are hunting rabbits in fields illegally, you're going to be using long dogs, which are not used on a rough shoot. If you are hunting a fox with a pack, or trying to flush a fox with a pack, then you'll be using hounds. On a rough shoot, you use spaniels, labradors, occasionally HPRs. There is very little way you could get these things mixed up or use one as a loophole.
Okay, thanks. Jim?
Very briefly, actually, Jake's just touched on it. From the police's point of view, would you be in a position to take a judgment if you arrive in a shoot and there are eight dogs there, but they're all Labradors and Spaniels?
I think based on that, we wouldn't necessarily need to take action at that point. We'd sort of speak to experts and try and gather all the information we've got to make a judgment on, you know, is this a legitimate rough shoot, or is it someone, you know, posing an illegal act as a rough shoot? So that's something we take into consideration, the breed of dog and so forth, and we'd look to speak to experts in that.
So you would take a consideration based on what you find when you are asked to go out to an event?
Yeah, we'd look at everything. We'd gather as much information as we could. Yeah, yeah.
Thank you,
Robbie, and then Rachel.
Thank you. Yes, I just wanted to back up Billy Telford's kind of observation about the danger. If there are multiple dogs in use, that can be formed as what I would describe as a smokescreen for illegal hunting, which has been illegal for over 20 years in Scotland, and which I think the reason why we're all sitting here today is because it's Lord Bonamy concluded that flushing to guns, which was an exception in the current law, has been exploited and used as a smokescreen to allow illegal hunting to happen, and that there was a need to strengthen the existing law. And what we're looking at in front of us is the strengthening of the existing law, which means that one of the things we need to consider is, are there potential loopholes in the legislation or in amendments to the legislation which would enable a mounted hunt to say that we're actually doing this? Because right now, what's been going on is that mounted hunts have been going out saying we are flushing to guns, and that's one of the exceptions in the 2002 Act. And it's been shown that that was a subterfuge and that it was a smokescreen. And as I say, that's why we're here today. So my watchword in all of this process is to look at the proposed legislation and the proposed amendments through the eye of somebody who would like to try and find a way around it, as we have had clear evidence that has been done for 20 years now. So any suggestion that rough shooting should be enable more than two dogs worries me, because as soon as you're allowed out in the countryside with a pack of hounds, If you have a smoke screen, a reason, or a loophole, then it's very easy to claim that that's what you're doing. And that's the concern that the League Against Cruel Sports has. And that's the way that we're looking at all of the bill. And particularly as we've been talking more and more about rough shooting and less about traditional mounted hunting, which is what I think we're all here to make sure that we really stop, which is what we thought we'd stop 20 years ago. I feel as if we always ought to come back to is this bill going to stop traditional mounted hunting? That's why we're here. That's what we want to do, as I understand it. That's why the government introduced the bill. And so that's the focus I will always bring to this discussion.
Rachel Hamilton.
To ask DS Telford, how many of the I don't know what to call it. How many activities have you been called out to in the description that Robbie Marsland gives in terms of what he says is a smoke screen for rough shooting? And could I ask Alex Hogg, on the back of the description of using rough shooting as a smoke screen, I mean, is that a reflection of what you see as what rough shooting is for? Because I noticed that the SGA gave a submission around saying that people attend a rough shooting with the intent for the dogs to flush the game for guns to shoot. So, is there some sort of interpretation here that is not true?
Probably we mix up. The rabbit, as a rule, just lives near its burrow or just outside in rushes and near a wood. It's never far from safety. So when you actually bolt a rabbit, it takes for cover. It's got in cover in seconds. Whereas a hare, excuse me, lives out in the open all the time. And a hare can be hunted with dogs. So we need to separate the two species and make sure that rabbits don't get caught up in what we're trying to aim for.
Okay, Billy.
So in terms of instance reported to us whereby illegal acts are in the guise of a rough shoot, I can't give you exact figures, but certainly I don't recall any such incidents being reported to us.
Do you recall any time that rough shooting has been used as an excuse for illegal activity?
No, I don't.
No, okay. I'm going to come to Ross and then Robbie and Jim.
Thanks, Convener. So I think I'll just back up what's kind of been said thus far. Jake very eloquently described, I think, why it would be difficult for a rough shoot to masquerade as something that was potentially illegal. And I think the thing that we just really need to reflect on here for a second is, the aim of this bill is to minimise the risk of wild mammals being caught and killed by dogs in the course of hunting. The Scottish Government, I think, if I'm honest, what's happened here is a mission creep. So in seeking to try and close the loopholes that surround it at the moment, it has quite illegitimately impacted on what was never meant to be within the scope of this legislation. And we do now have a situation where there's a lot of people very, very worried about the potential implications of the provisions of this bill on an activity, as I say, that was never meant to fall within the scope of it. So I think, I just back up what Jake said there. I do not think it is realistic that a mounted hunt could masquerade as a rough shoot in any sense whatsoever.
Jim, I'm going to bring Jim in first because you did indicate.
Okay, I'd rather hear what other folk
okay.
have to say.
Robbie and Jim.
Thanks, Jim. I just wanted to come back to the question that Rachel Hamilton asked, and Billy's answer. Before the 2002 Act, no mounted hunt ever went flushing to guns. That wasn't something they ever did. Mounted hunts went traditional hunting. That's what they wanted to do, and that's what's very important to them, and I understand that. But that activity was banned, in effect, by the 2002 legislation. And the very next season, for the first time ever, Scottish mounted hunts declared that they were going flushing to guns. for the first time ever. So the question about have there ever been any concerns about rough shooting? Of course, the answer is no at the moment. As I said before, my worry is that this legislation introduces new ways, in my parlance, new loopholes. I don't think they would be intentional by any means, but any opportunity for anyone to go out and say that they were doing illegal activity, which gave them the smokescreen to do an illegal activity, is very worrying to me. And one of the things that I went into this thinking, I know very little about rough shooting, very little. I mean, I think no one would be surprised about that. And I went into this thinking, well, that's not going to be a problem, because Ross is probably right. You can never say there were rough shooting and being on horseback and that. But then I was thinking, the more I hear about this, then the definition of rough shooting is really broad, really broad. I mean, we've heard different descriptions of it here. So what is to stop somebody on horseback with a man with a gun waving it around to say, yep, we're rough shooting, and we've decided to go rough shooting? What's the difference to that between, yes, we're flushing to guns, we've decided to flush the guns for the first time ever, which is what happened in 2002. So again, that's the caution I place before you, that we mustn't allow what I would describe loopholes to go through this legislation.
I'm going to come to Jim, and then Rachel's got a specific supplementary on this.
No, answer that first. I'm keen to hear other people.
What kind of dogs are taken on a rough shoot, and who is in control of them, and are they in control, Alex?
Well, you've got dogs, you've got labs, and you've got spaniels, and you've got hunt point retrievers. That's your type of dog, and your dog for hunting. Foxes would be hounds, so it's a totally different ballgame, totally different. And you cannot mix the two of them up.
I've got a number of hands, and I want to try and bring everybody in an order. So I'm going to bring... Okay. You're okay, Jim. I've got Alistair, Mercedes, and then Jake.
Thank you, convener. Coming back to you again, DS Telford, since you've raised some interesting questions. I realise you're not here to say what the law should be, but one of the discussions we've had is about whether some of the complications you're talking about would be there or not if a limit of two dogs applied to a rough shoot as a whole, so there could only be two dogs at the shoot. Now, whether that's right or wrong, I'm interested to know, given we've been discussing this, whether that's a simpler or more enforceable solution in your view.
Can I add to that? And to add to your complication, if you've got six people out shooting and they're all 50, 60 metres apart and they've all got two dogs each, how do you make that differentiation? Would you have the capacity to be able to make that differentiation?
Okay. So ultimately, and I'll say obviously Police Scotland are impartial, so I'm just commenting on the sort of ease of gathering evidence and so forth. So yes, if there was two dogs, ultimately that would make it more straightforward. It would reduce the question of has a pack formed, and so forth. If there was obviously a line, if the dogs were separate, that's where we would need to make our assessment as to whether a pack had formed. If we knew straight from the bat that when any alleged incident had happened, that there was a significant distance between the pairs of dogs, that's fine. The complication is, I suspect, it will not necessarily be that cut and dry as to where dogs were at a particular time if allegations are being made. But we'll work with whatever legislation we've got and gather the evidence accordingly.
One issue there is that the bill team leader, Leigh, said last week that if the dogs did form a pack, and we're not sure what the definition is, as long as owners tried to separate them, but surely the offence would have been committed. That's a bit like saying, I've caught you speeding at 70 mile an hour, but as long as you slow down, that's okay. So she's implied that if they were forming a pack, as long as they were separated, but the offence would have been committed.
Yes, I suppose off the top of my head, we'd need to look at what measures had been taken, had they taken reasonable measures, and then you're getting into what's the definition of reasonable, but had they taken suitable measures to stop the pack forming in the first place. So, yeah, I suppose we need to take every case and its merits, but they should certainly be taking measures to stop that happening rather than just say, oh, they've formed a pack, you know, we'll try and pull them back without implementing those measures.
Okay. Mike Flynn.
Back to your original bit, what's your views on rough shooting? My view is that it is for a sport or a pastime, as already has been referred to, it's a social or an enjoyable event and not seen as essential in terms of the other stuff that's going on. And I do have sympathy if this changes with Police Scotland, Mr Telford and his colleagues, because it will not be clear. And when you look back at some of the cases that have happened, people that do break the law, and I'm talking about lawbreakers, not your lawful members of the public, if there is a potential loophole there, they will try and use it. And I know the bit that Mr Hogg's saying about the dogs that are used for rough shooting, but the law as it stands, this bill as it stands, says dogs. It doesn't differentiate between separate breeds. So I've genuinely got concerns. Thank you.
OK, I'm going to bring in Jake, and then Mercedes, and then Ariane.
Thanks, Convener. I've just got a number of concerns relating to, well, primarily some of Robbie's comments. It seems like, admittedly, you've said that you've little to no experience in rough shooting, but you seem to take every opportunity to beat hunting foxes with hounds over the head. I'm not sure we're in the right session for that, really. So. I'd like to come on Rachel's comments as well about the which dogs are normally on a rough shoot, and the obedience levels as well. So you, as Alec quite rightly said, you'd be looking at spaniels, you'd be looking at labs, some terriers even are in the beating line. I know terriers that are very good at flushing and even picking up as well. But to give you an idea of the level of training, I know this was raised by, I think, Mike as well in one of the evidence sessions to begin with, one of the six sessions, about the obedience levels. And this is completely different to hunting with a pack of hounds and hunting separately working one, two or three individual dogs. And so, for instance, I've got an 18-month-old Cocker Spaniel. She is primarily a deer dog. Her name's Myrtle. She's a very cute little thing. And she is absolutely phenomenal at deer stalking. And she is ridiculously well trained, as are most dogs that go on these shoots. They're individually trained. There's a lot of time and effort put into them. And if Myrtle starts to do something that I don't want her to do, I can stop her instantly. And that is really the case with most of the dogs on these shoots. If you turn up with a dog that doesn't do that, you will not be invited back for that shoot again. I can say that categorically. Gamekeepers and land managers have a job to do and they have a reputation to uphold, particularly if it's their livelihood as well. So they will not tolerate dogs that run in, dogs that chase. And as Alec rightly said, I control rabbits as well. I've shot for over 30 years. I've worked dogs for over 30 years. I've been involved in training police dogs as well. If you go into a field full of rabbits, which I often have, having been a rabbit controller as well, as part of my general duties, you can, after you fire one shot under a lamp, the field will empty because the rabbits are virtually next to their holes and they don't stray far from the holes. They're completely different scenarios, and I'd like to get that on record.
Thank you. Mercedes.
Thank you. It was just a follow-up question to what Alex said about the different breeds of dog that are used on different kinds of activities to flush different kinds of prey. Are foxes ever flushed on a rough shoot?
Odd times, yeah, it will happen, and quite often they might be shot if it's safe to do so. But it's, normally it's by accident, it's not intentional. They get up out the cover, and if you're wanting to try and have your conservation or your curlews and things, we will shoot it in the course of what the eye.
Would a fox be included in the definition of ground game?
Well, so you would never eat fox for obvious reasons. That would not taste good. But you know, the main rationale, the main motivation for controlling foxes, just as Alex says, it's for biodiversity. You know, managing predation is what it's all about. You would never eat it under any circumstance. But as Alex says, you can control them. And you know, if you've got evidence of fox predation, a lot of rough shoots will do that. We do that on my shoot. You know, if there's a dog fox that's moved in, we'll often control it to reduce its impact on the ground nesting birds that we've got on the ground. Not least woodcock.
So then does it follow that the absence of hounds doesn't necessarily rule out that so, foxes have been flushed, that they've been killed on, in
so
activity?
There are no circumstances under which a dog on a rough shoot would ever be able to kill a fox. That just would never happen, ever. What would happen is that the fox would be disturbed probably well before the dogs even got there, because they're very attuned things. It would be flushed, and if there was a gun, you know, close by, near enough to shoot it, it would be shot. There is absolutely no chance whatsoever, for all the reasons Jake has set out about the training with gun dogs, but also the fact it's just not in their nature to try and rip a fox apart. It just wouldn't happen.
Peter, then Jake.
Yeah, just like to echo what Jake and Ross have actually said, it would actually be dangerous if the dog ran out and was chasing a rabbit. And obviously, as Jake was saying, you just would not be asked back. Your dog would be out of control. I know from my point of view that, yeah, exactly, if I took a dog along to shoot and it behaved like that, I'd be asked to leave, and it just would not be acceptable. Just going back to the point that Alex Hogg made about ground nesting birds, you know, capercaillie numbers are declining significantly. You know, it's our Scotland's iconic bird species, and I think we've got to be very mindful that if we remove the tools in which we can control fox numbers and the predator control against these endangered species, we risk losing these birds for, well, they're driven to extinction. So I think we've got to be very careful and in a measured approach that we have these tools at our disposal to protect endangered species such as the capercaillie.
Okay, briefly, Jake.
Sorry, briefly, yeah. Many of the rough shoots that I've been on have actually said that if a fox breaks cover, then do not shoot it. So it's, there is a level of restraint as well on many rough shoots. So it's not, as some people might describe, as you know, a bloodbath or blood sport. There is a respect and a level of restraint on many of these shoots as well.
Okay. If it's on the same, I've got Ariane and Jim. If it's a supplementary to this, Jim, I'll bring you in now, and I'll, or Alec.
Really quick one. If you go to a dog trial, when the rabbit is shot and brought back to the judges, the first thing the judges do is feel for any damage to that rabbit's ribs. And if the gun dog has chomped its ribs at all, that dog is put in a lead and sent home. So that's how soft-mouthed they are. You know, the last thing we want to do is breed a gun dog that's going to kill a game or stuff like that. So it's totally different times.
Ross, on this specifically.
Yeah. Just a very quick point, convener. I think it's just very, very important that we clarify here. The Scottish Government has got their policy intention, which is absolutely fine, but I think what we've heard here in this discussion reveals that, you know, rough shooting is going to be impacted in a way that is negative. And I think the Scottish Government has got an obligation to act proportionately in trying to close the loopholes, which is completely legitimate, but they need to do so in a way that does not impact on other legitimate countryside activities that have never been within the scope of this bill.
Okay. Ariane.
Thanks, convener. I think it's interesting that we're talking about rough shooting as we do it today, now. And I think what we're trying to establish here is that if we bring in this legislation, then rough shooting could be, as Robbie Marsland said, could be used as a smokescreen. So it could be that rough shooting is carried out in a different way, not by people who are genuinely rough shooting, but by people who want to use that as a loophole. So I want to pick up a bit of a thread of conversation that was happening a wee while ago with Billy Telford around intent. So person, intent, activity, dogs. Is it possible to establish intent? Could you talk a little bit about how do we establish intent? If people are, is there a way to ascertain that there, you know, that people were planning to do this? Because surely if you're going to use it as a loophole, you're going to have to plan it a bit in order to get those dogs that are no longer spaniels or labradors but are actually hounds together into a place along with horses, right? Something needs to be actually pulled together in order to do that. So just but anyway, anything about intent would be helpful.
Yeah, of course. And you know, we'd be wanting to gather as much evidence as possible. It wouldn't be simply a case of, you know, right, that's the bare minimum evidence we've got to libel this charge or to disprove it. We'd be gathering as much information as possible. And so, yeah, off the top of my head, obviously, breed of dogs would be a consideration, you know, but that's not to say, you know, as you're perhaps suggesting, people might change the breed of dogs they use to, you know, depending on their intentions and to create a smokescreen or so forth. But we'd also, you know, we potentially have the opportunities for phone seizures and so forth. So we would use as many investigative tools we've got available to us to establish any offences or disprove any offences.
Okay, thanks. Rachel?
I just wondered if... I'm getting slightly confused because I thought Alex said that rough shooters would never go out with hounds. Would you ever use hounds to...
No.
Right.
No.
But okay. Kavita, the point is that they wouldn't use hounds now and he would never use a hound. But somebody might use a hound once this legislation comes into play. So we're not talking about how people do it now. And I totally get one for the pot and all of that and good. But it's when this legislation comes in, it could be being used by people who consciously choose to find a way through because they can say, we're on a rough shoot. And they can plan to do that, and it will not be genuine people who are genuinely doing rough shooting. It's people who want to do mounted hunting. That's the concern.
Could I just further add to your question? Your answer said, so, we would, as much as we're talking about evidence and so forth, there's still, you know, the ability to use common sense as well, and for us to have a degree of judgment to say, in the balance of probability, what is this? Is this a legitimate rough shoot, or is it something else? So there's evidence and there's sort of common sense as well, and that would take into account types of dogs and so forth as well.
Jim.
Convener, thank you very much. That is exactly where I was going to go with all of those questions, that the legitimacy of what BASC and everybody at the SGA and everybody else does is not the question. It's the people who are going to come behind you with the legislation as it currently stands and say, yeah, well, this is a potential loophole. And Robbie's absolutely correct. There was never such a thing as flushing to guns for fox hunting previously, but now there is. So there is a potential for a loophole there. So my question to you guys that are in the shooting, if the government's position stays that two dogs are the limit and that's what it's going to be, can you still rough shoot?
So, I mean, I'll speak from my perspective, Jim. I'm just speaking from the perspective of the shoot that I shoot on in Perthshire, in your constituency. I would have reservations. I think we'd have to significantly alter the way in which we do the rough shooting in order to comply. And I think that would potentially happen in quite a damaging way, in the sense that I don't think the shoot would probably feel comfortable running more than two dogs overall in the day, because I think it would be open to vexatious allegations if we did, to be frank.
Okay, I understand that you feel it might be open to vexatious allegations. But could your shoot still function with two dogs?
Not to the same level it is now, and I think that's the important thing. We, as a shoot, have done absolutely nothing wrong, and to be honest, I do not see why we are being, in a sense, punished for the actions potentially of some others. I think the obligation should be on the Scottish Government to find another way in which to deal with this issue without impacting on activities that hitherto have been perfectly legitimate.
Okay, I would have thought that laws were always on the basis of the people who would abuse the law as opposed to the ones who are keeping with it. But anyway, you still be able to, let's ask SGA and Jake, would you be able to function a rough shoot with two dogs if that was your limit?
Difficult, because you've got tiredness coming in the dogs, you've got, you know, all these different things you want to train on dogs. All the different things you would need to to make the day happen. And the dogs are working so hard and covered that you would never believe. You know, rushes, you try getting through rushes, just walking through them in thick rushes. They've got to hunt like mad to produce what we're trying to get achieve. And it would curtail it a lot.
And we'll move on.
Thanks. Yeah, it's an interesting one. It depends on what your take on or your definition of function is. If you take your car into a garage and ask them to do a full service on it, give them one spanner, they'll be able to function. But whether you actually get something that's positive out of it at the end, then it's very unlikely. And for me, if the bill passes as it is, then rough shooting will end as it's practiced now. So
you would need more than two dogs.
Jim,
hold on a wee second.
No.
This is really important.
Could you stop, please? Thank you. Jake, could you finish and then move on to Peter?
So I rough shoot. I go out. I did have two dogs at one point. I've now got one. I used to walk up the hedgerows, let the dogs flush and shoot. So that's rough shooting. Also, rough shooting is going out exactly as Ross described it. So yes, it could still function if I go out with my one or two dogs, which is very, very minimal impact and makes absolutely no conservational benefit whatsoever. But it will cease to function as Ross described it.
Yeah, briefly, I'll just say, as Ross said, it will cease to function as it currently is. And I would just like to say that the way the bill is drafted causes concerns amongst our members. It creates ambiguity and people, the way I read it, I wouldn't be able to go out in the way that I do currently. And a lot of that would be echoed by the way that Ross described how a rough shoot functions. So, yes, it is hindered and curtailed by this bill.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to Alistair Allen, another topic we just want to delve into a little bit more deeply. Alistair.
Thank you. The government has offered some clarification about the proposal to permit two dogs per person on a shoot. I'm curious to know, firstly, whether what your view is about those clarifications, but also, as we've discussed today, one of the alternatives to that is obviously two dogs per shoot as a whole. So, again, as part of my question, I'd be interested to know what the implications, although you've mentioned this, what the implications would be on a rough shoot of limiting to, whether it be possible with two dogs on a shoot as a whole, and whether it would restrict what you do in terms of wildlife control or merely as a social event.
To be frank, Mr. Allen, both would be impacted. I think the clarifications, although I can see it's in the spirit of trying to be helpful, there is a fundamental misunderstanding, I think, about how gun dogs behave. You know, it's not a case that when you've got, if you're working two or three dogs in front of you, that they work kind of in a line going forward. They move around, they go left, they go right, they cover other dogs' ground. And the thing that I'm most concerned about with this is that if you did have a copse which was well covered and you had more than two dogs working in it, I would be really concerned that the whole thing would become open to vexatious allegations. It would be quite conceivable for someone who had an anti-shooting agenda to phone up the police and say, what they're doing there, I've seen more than two dogs go into that wood and I've seen a hare come out, that should be investigated. That's what I'm worried about with this. It's the...
You wouldn't open the vexatious questions, though, in the hypothetical situation that you only had two dogs.
Yes, but what I'm saying is two dogs would not be sufficient in the vast majority of cases for rough shoots. I've been on so many rough shoots, in the 24 years that I've been on this earth. And I don't think I've ever recalled a situation where we've just had two dogs working. It's just not something that happens.
Hey, Ariane.
You heard earlier about the types of dogs. So surely if you've got a range of dogs, Labrador, Spaniel, but the loophole aspect, we're talking about in the future and how it might be used, is that people who were fox hunting would have hounds. So that would be a clear indication at the moment as to the difference, a way for the police to see the difference between a rough shoot being used as a smokescreen and a rough shoot that is a genuine rough shoot. So you could tell it potentially by the type of dog.
I would say yes. Things are at the stand at the moment. Yes, that's the difference between the two. One of the differences between the two.
Could it be possible in the future, and I don't know enough about dogs, but could it be possible in the future to train Labradors or Spaniels into... Yeah, that's what I'm wondering, right? So that's the thing, right? Expression on the face is definitely not, right? So That's the thing that we need to be really getting into, is that we're talking about dogs that will work as a pack. Would Labradors who are out on, people's dogs who are owned by and in the control of separate people on a rough shoot, could they potentially form a pack?
So it depends. The dogs are trained to do fundamentally different things. So it's not about whether they form a pack or not. It's about what that pack, if it is a pack, if that's what you're going to call a group of dogs working together, what they're actually doing. In the case of a Labrador or a Spaniel, the clear objective is to flush, and then if you shoot, then retrieve. It's fundamentally different for hounds, which are trained, you know, for a completely different reason. Let's be real, we all know what that is.
Yeah.
So I do think that there is a plausible distinction here between the two, based on the type of dog that is used.
So that's the way in which this could be enforced, is that
potentially
there's a difference,
yes,
in the dog. So it's not, maybe it's not such a worrying thing after all, that this is in the,
I think it depends, Ms. Burgess, on the definition, and we obviously would need to come, and that would need to be looked at, but the definition of rough shooting would be crucial, I think, as part of all of this. But yes, I think you raise an interesting point.
Yeah, my views on rough shooting are that dogs are used to flush, not to chase. And if a dog chases, you put it on the lead and you take it home and you don't get invited back again. It's clear and simple. Yeah. But that's it's clear to me, but the legislation doesn't appear to make it clear on definitions. Mercedes.
So earlier on, if I've understood correctly from Mr. Ewing's contribution, he explained that the purpose of rough shooting is not necessarily about controlling wildlife and more to do with enjoyment and potentially providing food. So will this legislation prevent that?
Yes, in its current form. So it will prevent the enjoyment, but for those shoots that do have...
In what way will it prevent enjoyment?
So one example, Ms. Villalba, would be, so say we were limited, so my shoot, for example, took the decision on the back of this legislation to use two dogs only. I can tell you that we would flush far fewer birds, far fewer hares, far fewer rabbits than we currently do on the shoot. And in fact, in some places, in some parts of the ground, I'm not convinced that we would actually put any quarry up whatsoever. So the result would be a wholesale loss of enjoyment in the day, one. But two, if there is the management aspect, which we do control the hares for management on the ground to prevent grazing, that would also suffer as a result of this. So the farmer on whose land on which we shoot would also suffer as a direct consequence of the provisions of this bill.
And so the enjoyment is directly linked to the yield?
Not necessarily. I mean, that is something that I think, from my perspective, I mean, clearly it helps if you shoot something, because I quite enjoy the eating aspect. That's what really underpins it for me. But it's not a one-way thing. Other people have different appreciations for rough shooting. Some people just like going out, you know, whether you shoot something, it's kind of, you know, obsolete. But others, you know, you do go out with the intention of shooting something for food or managing, as you say,
wildlife. And would that be
wildlife possible
with just one or two dogs?
As in, would it be possible to shoot something?
Yes.
I mean, I think you might get something, but it would be considerably less than what you currently get on a normal rough shoot.
Can I just pull this back a little bit and remind everybody that there is not a two-dog limit on rough shooting? This is what the issue is, I think, and this is one of the reasons we're here. The Cabinet, the Minister has said that you are allowed to use more than two dogs. It's how the use of those two dogs are defined and how ultimately... That can limit rough shooting. So bear in mind, we're not talking about a two-dog limit here, because the Minister has made it quite clear that you can use more than two dogs.
He did say that he would consider reducing the shoot to only two dogs because of fears about vexatious...
Yes, which is
accusation.
Which is an unintended consequence of the bill that would happen as a result of this. I mean, I just would not feel comfortable...
So I just wanted to establish, which I think we have,
yeah,
whether or not some form of enjoyment and killing could take place, and it sounds like it could.
It could, but to a much, much lesser extent. And like I said from the outset, this was not the proposed target of this piece of legislation. It seems unfair and disproportionate that me, you know, and the people on my shoot, as an example, have to suffer as a result of the actions of others. Yeah, it's part of my enjoyment, and I stand by those words.
I'm going to bring in Billy.
Been asked, Ash. What enforcement measures would you expect then in relation to the two dogs?
What enforcement measures?
Yes.
Well, I mean, imagine it would be, you know, if you got a call from a member of the public saying that there was more than two dogs working, the police would be called out, and I presume they would investigate it, and I imagine that would result in the shutting down of the shoot on that day.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Ariane, then Alec.
Yeah, just to kind of come back, Mercedes asked about the two dogs, and you're talking, Ross, about the fact that you would lose enjoyment, but why would you have to reduce it if we've established that the types of dogs you use on a rough shoot are not hounds that hunt in packs? Why would you have to reduce the number of dogs? Because, you know, unless people, you all, and you kind of like, I heard laughter when I said, could a Labrador be trained to work in a pack? So if you're using dogs that won't, could never, ever, don't say never, ever, but could would be unlikely to be used in a pack, then surely having a number of dogs at your rough shoot is fine, because they're not hounds that hunt in a pack, that kill in a pack.
I'm not going to let you answer that, because I think the answer was in the question that Ariane asked. We've heard your view on that. I'm going to move to Alec.
It's just quickly to say there could be welfare issues here, because our whole detra is to retrieve anything that might be wounded on the shoot. That's absolutely, you know, you would walk 10 miles to make sure that that had been retrieved properly. And if you're going to, I can give you an example. I've got a wee black cocker called Maggie. We were at the grouse last week. There was a cock grouse towered in behind the butts. The picker up was there with six labs, and we never found it. So I said, right, on you go, Maggie. And she found it. You felt so damn good that you'd stopped any suffering. You got your bird back. You got everything done right. And that's what we might cut into if we restrict it to two dogs. We need option stuff. Quite often a dog might have as good a nose as another dog, and all different things.
Yeah. Peter.
Yeah, I'd just like to say that it goes back to the point that Ross made. You know, rough shooting is an important part of the social fabric of rural Scotland, and, you know, it boosts mental health and well-being in the countryside. I know that there's nothing better than getting out in the fresh air and being amongst people and doing a walked-up shoot. But it's also a sort of cost-effective way of shooting and, you know, a conduit for beginners to get into shooting. And I think we have to be mindful of this for the next generation, particularly Alex Hogg. You know, for gamekeeping, it's an important way of getting people into shooting, and it's a humane way of shooting. And it's, you know, very important that we respect the fact that this is a way that people get into shooting at a very beginner level. It's a way that I did, so I know a way that Ross Ewing did and Jake did as well. So I think it's really important that this is protected and it is not hindered by the bill.
I'm going to bring my Mercedes and then Alistair.
Thank you. Yeah, I was just wondering if we have, just on that point, if we have any data on the proportion of residents of rural areas that take part in rough shooting?
If I may answer that briefly, I know that from a BAS point of view, we've got 11,000 members in Scotland. I don't have the specific data on that, but I'd be happy to go away and try and find it for you if I could write back to the committee.
Alistair.
Yeah, thank you. Just a brief question or observation, really. I understand the points that people are making about retrieving birds, but just to be clear, this bill is not about birds, it's about mammals. So, you know, interesting and useful as those points are, you know, the bill wouldn't touch on them, as far as I understand.
Okay. We're going to move on. Beatrice.
Thanks, convener. I mean, we've obviously touched on the...
Beatrice, my apologies. I've missed you. Would you like to come in? My apologies, sorry.
Thank you, convener.
Kirsty, sorry.
I just wanted to come back to the main purpose of this bill. The Minister has said several times that this bill is in pursuit of the highest standards of animal welfare whilst allowing legitimate control. It's not entirely clear to me how an exception for sport sits within that, but the exception does exist. I don't see why rough shooting should be treated any differently than any other activity under Section 6. And I think we seem to be getting away from that main purpose of the bill.
I've got a question. Have you any evidence at all that there's been any incidents whatsoever relating to rough shooting when it comes to animal welfare?
I've heard you mention this before. You've mentioned before that nobody said anything about rabbits. We supported the inclusion of rabbits in this bill right from the beginning. the reason we weren't asked specifically about rabbits, and we possibly didn't anticipate that the inclusion of rush shooting would start to be questioned in this way, which is why we didn't speak more specifically about rabbits. A rabbit is a sentient wild animal and will suffer in the same way as any other wild animal when they're hunted, flushed, shot, whatever. So, of course, there are the same concerns for rabbits as there are for other wild animals.
But again, this is around chasing. The Minister has repeatedly said it's about chasing, catching and killing a wild mammal. That doesn't happen in a rough shoot. Again, if a dog was to chase rather than flush a rabbit and catch it and kill it, that dog would be removed because they're highly trained dogs. So I would dispute the fact that this rough shooting should play any part in this bill other than it's an exemption to ensure a perfectly legal pastime which is carried out to the highest animal welfare standards shouldn't inadvertently be caught up in this legislation, which is specifically to stop dogs chasing, catching and killing mammals.
I think it just goes back to the point that the exceptions to this bill should be as few and as narrowly defined as possible to avoid loopholes and to avoid situations where wild animals might be suffering.
Yeah, I certainly agree on that point. Peter Swishart.
Thanks, Convener. We have touched on some of the enforcement issues. My question will be for Billy Telford about the interpretation that was offered by the Scottish Government around enforcement of Section 6. And we had last week that the Government clarified that if a person shoots quarry flushed by another person's dog, it may be unlawful under some circumstances. So I just wondered what your views were on that.
Yeah, I'll be honest, I'm not entirely clear on it myself as to how it will work in real terms as to whether it's someone else's dog, but someone else has control of it. So, I'll be honest, I'm not entirely clear on that myself.
Okay. Anybody else want to comment on that?
Can I bring in Mercedes, who's got a supplementary on police understanding as well?
Yes. So, last week we... No, was it last week or earlier? It's all merging together. So we've heard that the use of dogs will be tied to the specific activity. That's the intention, the revised intention behind the bill. And if I understood correctly the evidence that we've taken previously, the government seems to be intending that if a person shoots a wild mammal which has been flushed by someone else's dog, as long as it was only one or two dogs that flushed the mammal, it won't fall foul of the legislation because for the purpose of that activity, those dogs can be claimed to be owned by the shooter. So I guess my question for Mr. Telford is, do you see any issues with the idea that dog ownership is interchangeable depending on the activity, depending on the time? How do you see that functioning?
Okay, so my understanding, and sort of touching on your question as well, which I would need to clarify as well as we move forward, especially if this is embedded in legislation, is that it's to do with the control of the dog rather than the ownership. So it's if they're using someone else's dogs, as long as it's determined that person is in control of them, is my understanding. So, yes, I do potentially see an issue, and there's an element of speculation in this, in that if there are multiple dogs present, if a pack may form or so forth, there may be some discrepancies or the potential for false claims that the actual dogs that undertook the act of flushing, were in the control of one person when in fact they weren't, or there were two separate dogs from two different people. I think that's just when you've got that number of dogs there. There is that potential. Does that answer your question?
Yes. Although I think confusion still remains in general.
It's slightly different from what we heard last week. So another scenario, and I'm going to bring Jim in because I know he'll have another scenario as well. I've got two people with two dogs
out in a walk with me, out in a rough shoot. I'm the only person with a gun. Those four dogs go in and they act up separately because they're Labradors, but they're hunting a undergrowth and they're all laid out. But in effect, they are working together because they're not covering the same area. These four dogs flush a rabbit, I shoot it. I'm not in control of those two dogs, but the wording is to use dogs, but those dogs were used to flush to me. It's four dogs, I'm then breaking the law. Because if I've got a gun, I'm not in control of the dogs that are flushing in that instance. But there's four dogs working at the game where the rabbit's towards me. So there's a grey area. I'll bring in Jim.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. The Basque definition of rough shooting is virtually all quarry species listed can be walked up, i.e. where shooters flush out the quarry as they walk through cover. So is there a concern from you as Police Scotland enforcing this? If you've got five guys out on a rough shoot and they've all got a dog or a couple of dogs each, but they're well spaced out and as they're walking and they've got enough space between them, that's not forming a pack, but it still allows them to enjoy the rough shooting. Would you be able to interpret that? If somebody then came to you and said, those people were walking through a wood, there was these dogs, and a rabbit or a hare was shot, would Police Scotland be able to interpret that scenario?
Yes. I mean, if there was the information available to us making it clear that's what had happened, it's based on those circumstances.
What would you use to interpret that scenario? Would it be the kind of dogs? Would it be the environment that you were in? Would it be how would you interpret it?
It would be all those things, because we need to, obviously, we may get told that there is a line of persons with two dogs equally spaced, but by the time we perhaps get there, you know, that might not necessarily be the case, or it might be afterwards, everyone's together. So we don't necessarily know which two dogs is with who and is where. So, yeah, it would be all those things. It would be witness statements. It would be common sense, it would be the kind of dogs, the kind of land. We'd be pulling together as much information as we could, because, you know...
Would it make any... And I'm purely thinking off the top of my head here. Would it make any difference to you if when you get there and you want to investigate this alleged vexatious crime, as Ross puts it, and you said, right, gather up your dogs, and you could clearly see Alec called two dogs, Ross called two dogs, and they all went back to them... Would that be part of your determination?
Yeah, I think it would, because it would show that these dogs, you know, what has happened at that time isn't necessarily linked to it, but it would certainly show that there is an intention to go out there with people in control of specific dogs. Okay. So it would certainly be a consideration.
So that actually kind of gets to the point of it, doesn't it, that rough shooting would still be allowed to be using more than two dogs, so long as these dogs didn't form a pack and the dogs were being controlled by one person who only ever had two dogs under their control. Would that sit with you, Ross?
Ms. Fairley, I think
on that particular point, I would still have concerns, because I think your average member of the public, when it comes to clarity, which is obviously what this bill is meant to bring, I don't think would necessarily be able to tell the difference between a dog working as a pack or not working as a pack.
But it wouldn't be the average member of the public you'd have to convince. It would be an officer of the law who was there with the specific understanding of what it was that you were trying to do.
But I think it comes back to how these incidents are flagged up in the first instance, is what I'd say. You know, if someone calls up, if someone's not able to clearly tell whether something's illegal or not, to me that's a failure in the legislation's clarity. And what this needs to do is that everybody, not just the police, needs to be clear about what constitutes an illegal activity and not. And in my mind, I mean, I'm still not clear, to be quite frank, and which is why I'm taking a very precautionary approach with respect to my own shoot on this. If this legislation were to pass, I would have severe reservations about using more than two dogs on the shoot, because I think it could be open to vexatious allegations, and it was not clear what constitutes an illegal activity or not. There's too much grey area in this.
But if you are accused of a vexatious allegation, surely when Billy and his crew arrive, and they ascertain very quickly that you hadn't done anything illegal at all, what would be the problem with that?
I'd hope that they would be able to, but I mean, the point is that it still results in disruption to the shoot day, which has resulted as a manifestation of the bill not being clear in the first instance, because someone has felt compelled to report it, which has disrupted your shoot day. You've had to stop activity to answer police questions, interviews. Maybe there'll be an appeal for information as well that will follow on the back of that. It just creates, to be frank, a whole load of bureaucracy when there doesn't need to be some in the first place. I think the most important thing here, Mr. Fairley, to be frank, is everybody, member of the public, police, people involved in the activity, need to understand very clearly what constitutes an illegal activity and not. And while this bill is intended to bring clarity of expression, what it does is create ambiguity with respect to a perfectly legitimate activity, which was never intended to be in the focus of this bill.
One thing, if you look at part one of the bill, it actually is quite clear. A person is using a dog when the hunting of a wild mammal by that person involves the use of a dog, even if the dog is not under that person's control or direction. Yeah. And related expressions are to be construed accordingly. So it's quite clear that rough shooting in that case would be very difficult.
Yeah.
Very difficult indeed to continue in circumstances other than when there was only two dogs, exception or not. I'm going to move on. Mercedes, yeah.
Sorry. Just a quick follow-up to DS Telford, just to... so I can understand a little bit around the practicalities of enforcement. In practice, I'm not sure how it works now, how you envision it working in the future, would you tend to be not joining, but visiting rough shoots or dropping in, or would it only become come into your sort of frame of work if there was an accusation or whatever of some illegality, or how does it work?
Yeah, certainly we don't tend to kind of do any sort of proactive visits to any rough shoots or anything like that. We wouldn't necessarily be aware of when they're happening, and I don't know whether that would necessarily change moving forward, but yeah, we don't really do that.
I suppose potentially a rough shoot could voluntarily notify that it was taking place if there were concerns that there might be accusations.
I think I'd come back on that point. I mean, what have we done wrong to merit this? You know, why is it that I should have to, you know, and declare on behalf of my shoot that we're doing X, Y, and Z today when we have got, there's no evidence whatsoever to suggest that we have ever been on the wrong side of the law?
Well, just for your peace of mind, I suppose.
Yeah, that's fine, but I just do not think it's proportionate for the Scottish Government to intervene in this way.
Okay. Jake and then Peter.
Thank you. It's very thoughtful of you to think about peace of mind, but I genuinely don't think we have an issue with that. I think Ross has been reading my notes as well, because literally the last 5 minutes he's covered most of the things that I wanted to bring up. What I will say, it's still not clear to me, and I'm hoping it's clear to somebody in here that they could explain to me what a pack is and how a pack is defined. Because in a beating line, if you have three dogs, two belonging to one person and one belonging to the next, when do they become a pack? And when Sergeant Telford turns up and tries to investigate it, not being there at the time when the alleged offence committed, which could be when three dogs were in a 10-metre vicinity, then it's going to be very difficult for Police Scotland to investigate something which they hadn't witnessed, which was in the middle of a very thick wood or an embankment of whin bushes, when something ran out and they have somebody say so to say that some dogs were working together. It needs to be defined what a pack is. So it's all very well saying people can walk in line with guns, with a dog or two dogs each. They can be 10 metres apart. If they have to go around a tree or a bush and they're now 8 metres apart and the dogs start working in front of them and close the gap by a couple of metres, is that defined as a pack? There are too many grey areas, and this bill was brought about, as the Minister said, to bring utter clarity, and it does not. It brings grey areas into something that should not be affected.
Peter and then Jenny.
Yes, quickly. I just want to say about proportionality. I think that the conversations going around today is that very concerning for our members that the police would have to be called out and potentially disrupt a shoot day. And I mean, the way the bill is currently drafted, and if that is going to be a consequence of that, that puts significant concern in me and other stakeholders likewise, I think we need to really hone in on this and make sure that people can go out and shoot with confidence, and I don't think this bill currently offers that opportunity.
Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for all the evidence so far. I want to return to the title of the bill, Hunting with Dogs, Scotland Bill, Hunting a Wild Mammal Using a Dog. Now, in all the definitions that we've received about rough shooting today, it's all been about around using the word flushing, not hunting. I think, Convener, you may have inadvertently used the word hunting when you were giving the example of your four labs and then corrected yourself. But what we're talking here about, as I understand it, please correct me if I'm wrong, is that the exception here allows, as the bill said, to search for, stalk or flush from cover. And that's basically what we're talking about rough shooting being. So I'd just like to clarify that my understanding of that is correct. And then the other area is about actually something that Jake Swindles just said about the definition of a pack. Again, in this section, it says that reasonable steps are taken to ensure that any dog used in the activity does not join with others to form a pack of more than two dogs. That to me implies a pack is more than two dogs, so three dogs. The reasonable steps, DS Telford, it'd be interesting to get your thoughts on that.
Yes,
and, but also, if I wouldn't mind to get Robbie Marsden's views, and also one of the people that are shooters, whether it's Ross or Jake.
So that's a fair question, and that's something we raised at the first evidence session. Is I think we requested some clarity around what reasonable steps would be. I suppose in the absence of a clear definition, we'd need to rely on sort of common sense. You know, can we determine if somebody's made any legitimate efforts to call back the dogs, you know, and so forth. So that's something we'd need to look at based on the circumstances. But if we could have some clear definition on it, it would be welcome.
Would there be a concern if you made a definition too defined that could impact, that could have unexpected consequences as well?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose that's the balance of things, in that definitions give you clarity, but at the same time, they kind of restrict you at the same time. certainly, I mean, yes, I don't know what a way around it would be, but we would have to just sort of look at all the circumstances to determine if reasonable steps, you know, had been taken. You know, if the dogs were looking at distance from other dogs, you know, vocal commands, and so forth. So, yeah, we just need to kind of assess everything we could in the absence of any sort of clear definition.
Okay. Rachel Hamilton.
I was hoping to hear from Robbie Marsden.
Oh, sorry, Robbie.
Thank you.
I said at the outset that I didn't know very much about rough shooting, and I've certainly learned a lot during this session. And some of the things that I've learned are that rough shooting is done primarily for enjoyment and the pot, which I agree with Kirsty Jenkins that seems to be at odds with a desire to be of the highest welfare standards. But I also have learned that it's possible to continue rough shooting in a restricted way with two dogs. I've heard that from all sides that would be possible. It would be at a reduced level. And as you can imagine, as the director of the League Against Cruel Sports, I would welcome that. But I see it as one of the compromises that we're willing to accept, that you can use two dogs in these sorts of circumstances. I've also heard that Police Scotland think that they would be able to understand, when there were more than two dogs, whether or not there were an offence being committed. We talked about distance and about vocal commands and common sense. I sometimes worry about common sense being one of the criteria, because I think if you apply common sense to what's going on with mounted hunts, then that's sort of a matter of conjecture. But those are the things I've learned, that this, the bill as it's written at the moment would enable rough shooting to continue at a restricted level, and that those people who are doing it feel aggrieved by that it would be at a restricted level. But I think their grievance should be directed at the mounted hunts, who for 20 years used other methods and loopholes, and that if there is a danger of this becoming such a loophole, then I think that restriction is something which we would all expect and in some ways welcome.
Rachel Hamilton.
Oh, it's a really daft question, but it's to DC Telfer again. Have you ever been called out to dog walkers with more than, say, three dogs, two dogs, however many, and it's been reported that they have ripped an animal apart?
A dog walker? I can't remember any specific instance off the top of my head, but yes, I think we probably have, yeah.
And so what happens in that sense is, does it tend to be somebody that is hair coursing, or is it a genuine mistake? So they have taken reasonable steps to control their dog, but unfortunately, because it's not a trained dog, haven't been able to control the dog, and therefore you've said, well, look, we understand it happens.
Yeah, so it's happened on both sides. So we have had incidents of dog walkers whose dogs have run off and killed animals. And again, I can't recall any specific incidents, but what we would do under those circumstances is to try and establish if they've taken reasonable steps. Have they been negligent, you know, where they're walking? So we would take into account all those things. We also get hair coursers using the excuse that, you know, they just let their dog off to do the toilet or get exercise, or up to this point, we're chasing rabbits. I suspect under those circumstances, if we could prove they'd killed a hare, you know, and we suspected they were hare coursers, we would look to like gather evidence to libel charges rather than just accept that the case it was an accident if there was a dead hare and other evidence to indicate they're hare coursers.
And what kind of dogs do hare coursers use to chase hares?
Lurchers, typically, yeah, that sort of dog.
I noticed that the latest figures show that there were 100 offences, prosecutions in Scotland around hare coursing, which was higher than I expected, actually, because I know there are a lot of reports, but not the ability to prove that hare coursing has been an offence. I just wanted to ask the people in the room about the exception for a bird of prey killing as reasonably as possible.
I think that kind of veers off rough shooting, Rachel, I'm afraid.
All right, no worries.
Yeah, we want to stick to specifically, or we could be here till next week. Thank you. Just on the police, I think it was quite clear from the evidence we took from the bill team early on and from the minister that they were caught out by the issues around rough shooting. I think most people, and I don't speak for most people, but I think most people would understand that there needed to be strengthened legislation around hare coursing, and including rabbits in this would appear to be the simplest solution. But in my opinion, the government bill team didn't appreciate what rough shooting was. And we heard from Hugh Dignan last week that he'd watched some YouTube videos, but really he hadn't done that until after the issue had been highlighted. And if I remember, Police Scotland also suggested that they weren't quite sure about the implications of rough shooting. In your opinion, would there be other better ways to catch hare coursers rather than the unintended consequences of almost banning rough shooting as we know it right now?
I mean, in terms of hare coursing, I think we had initially, at the initial consultation period, suggested that the phrase and reckless could be added in to sort of negate against that argument that, you know, they just let their dog off for exercise. Because ultimately, if we could sort of say they were lined up in a row, walking through a field, you know, even if we can't prove it's deliberate, it looks pretty deliberate, but even if we can't prove that, I would say that's a reckless act, because it's always a high chance that they're going to expose a hare and the dog will chase it. So I certainly Police Scotland thought that would be a kind of valuable addition.
So now looking back, and now we've heard the additional evidence on rough shooting, do you rethink the position on the introduction of the inclusion of rabbits in the definition and the implications it has with rough shooting, that wasn't thought out enough by the government, and that's why we're sitting around the table today? And do we need to look at further amendments to make your job easier?
That's a good point on rabbits, and you know, I kind of fully respect it's been added to make our enforcement powers more straightforward in relation to hare coursing, but I do see it does potentially create problems with rough shooting. I recognise that may create problems.
Okay, I'm going to bring Kirsty, then Jake, and then Ariane.
Thank you. I just wanted to clarify that the inclusion of rabbits in the bill was for two reasons, one of which is to help with detecting illegal hare coursing. The other is because rabbits are sentient wild animals and they're included for their own protection. And I think that's getting lost a little bit in this.
Thank you, Sergeant Telford. If I could just a point for you to consider and perhaps help out with. Were convictions concerned for using long dogs on rabbits, hare poaching, coursing? You mentioned recklessness, which I think would be a beneficial addition, but couple that with permission to be on the land itself, because recklessness wouldn't necessarily gain the conviction for hare coursing. But if you couple that with permission to be on the land, would that strengthen what you could do to gain a conviction for poaching?
Yes, I think it would, yeah.
Thank you.
And on the point...
Just on that point before I bring Ariane in.
It's the lurcher point that you made. I mean, would there be any other dog that they would use?
Lurchers, greyhounds, whippets.
Okay. Thank you.
A couple others, but yeah, it's fairly specific. It's only a couple of breeds.
Thank you.
Ariane Burgess.
And I just wanted to see if he might like to come in on anything. We haven't heard from him yet, and I just wanted to afford him the opportunity to speak to anything that's just been coming up. But just kind of recently, I noticed some expressions there, and I would love to hear your perspective.
I'm quite sure Mike is more than capable of indicating if he wished to come in and speak. So I appreciate you intervening, Ariane, but I will bring in Mike if he has a comment to make.
Well, I mean, if you look back at, as has been said here many, many times, this is primarily for people's enjoyment. It's a sport, in my opinion. Yes, it will control some species. If it's pest control or conservation, which has been mentioned a couple of times, there are sections that deal with that. Why should rough shooting or any kind of sport be above, so to speak, what I would class as essential purposes, essential pest control? If a farmer's got an infestation or something, they could apply for a licence through that. So I don't see why rough shooting or any sport should have a higher threshold, i.e. more dogs, than somebody that's doing it for an essential purpose and has got to have the scrutiny of a licence. So that's basically where I sit on that one. There is obviously issues going on. I still feel it will put the police in an impossible task. If the maximum is two dogs, regardless of how vexatious the complaint is, if they turn up and there's two dogs there, it's within the law. If there's three, are they a pack? Are they joining? Are they working together? All this kind of stuff. It just does not seem workable from an enforcement point. And for to answer one of Ross and Jake's questions, it wasn't a question from Ross and Jake. Everyone I know that's involved in rough shooting is a lawful, law-abiding citizen. But as soon as this becomes a loophole, the ones that are not law-abiding will use that as an excuse. And again, that will just tarnish everybody that's doing it lawfully. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. That was helpful. Jim Fairley.
Yeah, one very quick comment, and it is purely a comment, both from yourself, Robbie, and from yourself, Mike. The bill team stated last week quite categorically that the purpose of this bill was not to curtail hunting. The bill has to be about what the bill is about, but they did say that that would not entail the purpose of the bill was not to stop people from legitimately hunting. So I think that bit needs to be clarified, that that's out with the scope of this conversation.
Ross.
Yeah, I mean, I think I just raise a point on this as well, just because I'm mindful this is potentially coming up in the next kind of few years of this Parliament. But there's obviously questions raised about the SSPCA's capacity to investigate wildlife crime, and consideration is currently being given as to whether they should be afforded statutory powers. I think it's for exactly the reasons that the Chief Superintendent has set out there that I would have difficulties with the SSPCA having an investigatory role. And I think it's fair to say, and I'll ask...
Okay.
You want to leave it?
Yeah,
okay.
I think that's out with the conversation today. Mercedes, if it's on this point...
Jim's point.
Okay, Mercedes.
Just a quick comment on Jim's point about Jim Fairley's point about the purpose of the bill. I accept that, but I think we also need to be mindful of the effect of the bill. And what we're hearing is that the effect will be changes to current practices. So I do think that is important that we acknowledge that and explore that.
Yeah, I fully accept that that's in the bill, but it needs to be clear that the bill team actually stated last week that there was to be, this was not to be about curtailing people's ability to hunt. People should still be allowed to hunt.
Okay, we're going to move on to the very final questions. Karen Adam.
Thank you, convener. So I have learned a lot today, so thank you everybody for all your points and comments and questions. It's been really helpful. And, you know, I keep bringing this back, you know, right to the animal welfare point of this, and that is the purpose of the bill, is to stop mammals being chased down and ripped apart and killed. So what I'm hearing here in terms of rough shooting is that you already abide by quite high animal welfare standards. Yeah, you'd agree. And you do not want the animal to be ripped apart, punctured, anything that would ruin your enjoyment of eating the mammal as well if it was ripped apart before you got it. So in that case, you know, that would not be in the scope of the bill. But understanding there could be some unintended consequences that we're really looking into here. So what I'm hearing is that there won't be a limit on two dogs for rough shoots, but you're concerned about the perceptions, vexatious complaints, etc. But what I'm thinking is, I've got quite a lot of confidence in the police, to be honest. And I think we're not giving them enough, kudos for what they do and their understanding. And it's not just common sense. I think if I was to turn up to a rough shoot, I would know if there was a pack of hounds chasing down animals to rip apart, and the difference between dogs who were retrieving whole animals or whole birds. And I think the police have a great relationship with people in the countryside, particularly gun owners. You know, local police I know near me know people who own the guns and would do shooting in the area. So I know I'm kind of getting to the point of my question here. So, and I'm just seeing that in terms of the vexatious comments and that, if there is no breaking of the law, then there is nothing in those terms to be concerned about. It's the animal welfare that we're really pinning down on here. So I'd like to ask DS Telford, you know, in terms of the relationships with the police and people in the countryside, the police, they're trained to spot these kind of animal welfare concerns, surely, and the difference between rough shooting and a hunt.
Firstly, it's nice to be appreciated, so thank you very much.
Yes, we've always got a cadre of wildlife crime officers across the country. There's approximately 160, and in the 13 territorial divisions in Police Scotland, there's a wildlife crime liaison officer who has overview within that division. I have overview nationally. Amongst normal response policing and community officers, uniformed officers, there inevitably isn't that expert knowledge, because it is a very niche crime type. Certainly amongst the wildlife crime officers, there is that knowledge. I would certainly like to think as well. Obviously, though, even if you've got a good knowledge of the crime types and the modus operandi and so forth, sometimes with the likes of anything involving hunting with dogs, when we're talking about things that might involve multiple dogs and it's in a rural area with limited witnesses, there are those challenges presented. That's not to say, you know, rightly or wrongly, anything to do with the bill, but there are those challenges there, but we have to work with that.
Can I ask just a follow-up on that, Convener, if that's okay? If the police were forewarned of rough shoots being taken place in the area, would that be helpful?
I suppose there is a benefit to that. If we would have to look at what we were doing with that information, would we be using that information to proactively engage with the rough shoots? But then we'd need to make sure, as Ross said, we need to sort of have good relationships and maintain relationships, and we don't want legitimate rough shoots to be feeling like that they're persecuted. So yes, I definitely think there is something in that, but there maybe need to be further discussion had and sort of working on building relationships and so forth. But yes, there may be something in that. The issue would be if people that were, you know, it would only be legitimate rough shoots that would sort of welcome us, you know, people that were kind of using it as a guise for anything else, you know, probably wouldn't notify us.
So that would be a kind of telltale as well.
Yeah, yeah.
We have rapidly run out of time, but there's one or two people who quite like to still come in. You know, Robbie, Ross, and Jake, and Jim.
I just want to address the phrase which has been used all morning, which is vexatious complaints. It seems to me that all complaints are being discussed as vexatious. There's a difference between a vexatious complaint and a complaint. And in my experience, the police recognise a vexatious complaint. I think we all do. In terms of... that's the reason why when the League Against Cruel Sports submits evidence to the police, we are meticulous, and I know Billy Telford can testify to that, in the video evidence, the mapping, the witness statements. We certainly don't make vexatious complaints. And I just wanted to make that distinction that you know, there are complaints and there are vexatious complaints, and vexatious complaints don't usually work.
Okay. Ross?
Just to follow up on what Mr. Marsland said there, actually, I mean, I think it's worth everyone being mindful of the fact there are groups of people out there that do genuinely take it upon themselves to disrupt legitimate countryside activities, whether they be hunt saboteurs, but also increasingly that is infringing on game shooting, both driven grouse, pheasant, partridge, whatever. It is starting to infringe on a much wider scale. So I think we just need to be mindful of that. And just one thing that you mentioned there, Ms. Adam, in your question, you were kind of indicating that, you know, rough shooting wouldn't necessarily be curtailed. I mean, I do take issue with that in the sense that someone that wanted to run three dogs on a rough shoot, as they often do now, would have to stop doing so. And simultaneously, you know, I think a lot of shoots, as I say, if you're putting a number of dogs through vegetation, then they're going to have to limit that to two if they want to be absolutely safe.
But that wouldn't be a legal requirement.
It would be a legal requirement to you. You cannot use more than two dogs to flush a mammal from cover to then be shot.
But if that other dog belonged to somebody else, that would be a completely different...
No, my understanding is that any two dogs that result in the killing act that comes later.
Okay, thanks, Jake.
Intent,
and Peter.
Thank you. Just in relation to DS Telford's comments on reporting, you may or may not be aware, if you night shoot, Police Scotland now have the facility for you to be able to report that you're night shooting. Quite often, if people see a lamp in an area, they get concerned, or if they hear gunshots at night, then they will phone police. So they used to have a system whereby you call in and report it, which I've done many times. Unfortunately, I've been on hold for a significant period of time myself, and obviously with the staffing levels that Police Scotland are suffering at the minute as well, that might not be an appropriate thing to have to do for every rough shoot. So on a Saturday across Scotland, you might have upwards of 400, 500, 600 rough shoots, and Police Scotland dealing with those extra calls to have to report that, I think, will be problematic.
Jake said he's actually covered the point for me, but I'd also like to say that obviously the shooting community have very good working relationship with the police, and what's underpinned by a lot of this is also firearms regulations, which people have to have shotgun certificates, and so that underpins a lot of the trust too and the good working relationship we have.
Thanks. I just want to ask, because this is all about ensuring that the bill is about providing clarity and making a safer route to prosecutions to go ahead and be successful, to ensure that those committing wildlife crimes are prosecuted, and everybody would want to see that happen, to they get prosecuted to the full extent of the law. It's just unacceptable. However, do you feel that what's on the table at the moment does protect those who are legitimately carrying out country sport, because it's not here to ban country sport, or pest control or whatever, and does it give you enough confidence that the laws will allow you to prosecute those who are breaking those laws as it currently stands, or do we need to see it substantially amended? And one final thing I'd like to include. We've heard about breeds. Should there be something in there about breeds? Could we be confident if we said that certain animals were the only animals, breeds of dogs, were allowed to be used in rough shooting and whatever? Would that be something that you would find would work? And Jake's going to come in that as well, but I'll go to you first, Billy.
On that note, at face value, yes, but I think Mr. Fairley raised a valuable point at the last evidence session. The problem's getting to where you're talking about crossbreeds and things and opportunities to get round that. But yes, I think at face value that there would be a benefit to that. How it was managed and how it was defined would need to be worked on. But yeah, I think it would be of benefit, because there's a handful of breeds that are used for hare coursing.
I suppose often in legislation it could be, rather than having a list, unless nearly always exclude animals that later you would want to include. But if there was something in the legislation that said flushing for rough shooting purposes with a dog which is widely recognised, a dog that is trained for that purpose, that might assist.
I think it would assist.
Yeah. But at the moment, the bill, to make it easier for Police Scotland to protect those not committing crimes and prosecute those, the bill would need to be amended.
I think so. Just from some of the issues I raised kind of around the ability for us to gather evidence, particularly on the rough shoot issue.
Thank you. Okay. Jake.
Thank you. It was just, a word of caution, although it probably would assist if using a long dog such as a lurcher. I would suggest that in some beating lines, many terriers are used. They're very good at flushing game as well. So perhaps not to make it too restrictive.
Okay, thank you. And finally, I think, Mercedes.
Thank you. It's a further question around enforcement, and I'll be guided by the convener if he feels it doesn't fit here. So we've discussed issues around enforcing the Section 6 exception of no more than two dogs being used for sporting activity, and we've been talking today about rough shooting, and how it might be difficult to ascertain which dogs were used, who's using them, etc. So if this limit is taken out, would there not be, or could there not be, enforcement issues? Because then we would have activities taking place with more than two dogs, and so would there not be issues around enforcing the limit in other areas, non-sporting areas? So if we're talking about, for example, mounted hunts, would there not be confusion then? So I guess what I'm getting at is, although we've heard that there's enforcement issues around this limit in this instance, if it was not there, wouldn't there be other enforcement issues?
Yes, I suppose there would be. it's not an easy fix, and I'm glad I'm not the one kind of writing the bill. Yes, I don't quite know how to answer that, but I suppose there would. If there wasn't that two-dog limit, you know, if you'd removed the issue around kind of the number, that there's still potentially packs could still form, whether or not there's anything to do with two dogs. You know, there's still an issue of potentially packs forming. So, yes, there are challenges there as well.
Thank you.
OK. I'm going to bring in Jim and then Rachel to close the session, unless anybody's got any burning points right at the end. But Jim and then Rachel.
Ben, sorry, the pressure's on you today, but it's your job to enforce. Including rabbits in the definition of wild mammal will aid in the detection and enforcement of hare coursing offences by removing this activity as potential cover. It says that in the policy memorandum to this bill. Do you think that that this should be, if the government are hell-bent on including rabbits as in the definition of wild mammal, that if hare coursing offences do not improve in terms of prosecution, because at the moment obviously it's very, very difficult, Do you think that that should be looked at in a post-legislative way, and that there should be figures presented to the Scottish ministers regarding this? Because if this law doesn't work and hare courses are still not found to be breaking the law, do you think that's something that this committee should be considering?
I suppose that's probably not really for me to say.
Your job to make sure that people who are breaking the law are found to be guilty of breaking the law, and therefore one of the reasons that this bill is coming forward states categorically that it's to aid the enforcement of hare coursing offences. And I just wondered.
Yeah, so I may have picked up your question wrong. So I certainly think, in terms of enforcement of hare coursing, the addition of rabbits would aid police investigations.
Is that based on evidence?
Yes, I would say it is, because it's.
And can you give the committee that evidence from? Because I haven't seen that, so it would be good to have.
I mean, it's.
Sorry, it's just for amendments purposes.
Yeah,
that's all.
I think, if I get it right, it's whether there should be some reporting mechanism which would suggest whether the legislation is working in the direction it should.
And the evidence.
I think that's probably. Yeah, I think it's more a question for the government, and reporting rather than Police Scotland suggesting how they could work. But I think it's worth putting on record. Thank you. Jim?
Or is it Rachel?
Yes.
You skipped. Anyway, doesn't it? Contrary to what Robbie says, I'm a great believer in common sense. I think common sense is a great thing. I understand that it can leave loopholes. But I'm also very alive to the point that Mercedes makes, that it makes it a lot easier for the police to be absolutely certain that if there's more than two dogs, there's a potential for the laws to be broken. So my comment or question is, the working relationship that Peter talks about between Police Scotland and the shooting community is very, very strong on the basis of the fact that we all have guns, and the police therefore know who you are. They've already gone through that sort of process with you. So if the law stands as it is and the two-dog rule stays where it is, surely there will be a bedding in period of this law where the police know who the shooters are. Because I know in my area, the police know who is going out and doing that rough shooting. And if these vexatious claims are made against you, there may be a period of time where that has to be ironed out. But again, the police are going to get to know who's in the countryside making these are having these shooting days and who are the ones who are going to be breaking the law. So if the two-dog rule stands, well, is there enough there for you in terms of common sense, your understanding of what happens in the countryside, the people that you're dealing with, to be able to take a view that there has been no law broken here and we are comfortable to let it go? And why would that be so difficult for the shooting community to take on board on the basis that you also want to stop the illegal activities that are happening in the countryside? Surely that's the ideal compromise.
Billy, do you want to comment?
It's difficult to comment generally. Obviously we need to sort of consider all the circumstances at the time. It may be the case there's this issue, and I'll be honest, I don't know if this is common with rough shooting, but people with firearms coming from out with the area, I don't know if that's common, so that would maybe create a problem there. So,
whoever's organising the shoot will be within your locality. Who's organising that shoot is going to be within your locality, surely. Mm-hmm.
I think that's probably a difficult question to answer, but I think once again we know what direction you're moving in, Jim. I've got Ross has got a very, very brief comment, and if there's any other stakeholders like to comment on that, please indicate now, but we're 15 minutes over the session, unfortunately.
Mr. Fairley, it was just in response to what you said there. I mean, I think from our perspective, the absolutely central issue here is that aspects of the rough shooting practice, if you like, are going to be regulated quite unreasonably, in our view, by this bill. That is the central issue. So it's less about all the stuff around the periphery, but rough shooting is being impacted in a disproportionate way that is not consistent with the principles of better regulation. Okay. And that is our view.
Thank you. Peter.
Yeah, I think we need to decouple the two, and it's the way the bill's drafted fundamentally that creates the ambiguous nature of it, and I think that's what needs to be addressed.
Alex, just one thing. Everybody in here has got a couple of spaniels at their heel right now, and we all got up to leave to go out the door, and none of them are on a lead. Can you imagine the mayhem and then trying to suss out what's going on? It just, you've no control over it. Everybody making for the door and dogs everywhere. So, something to mind about. It's awfully hard to put your season on what you're thinking in real life.
Robbie, very, very briefly.
I just want to say thank you very much for organising this roundtable. It's very much appreciated. It's sometimes felt a bit lonely and a bit sort of being out of control, sitting on those seats over there. So it's been. I think everybody here will agree that this has been an excellent opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Robbie. I appreciate you putting that on the record. And we, as a committee, absolutely appreciate the responses we've got, which, you know, the call for further evidence was given very short notice. So we appreciate you travelling in today and your time, especially those who've travelled quite some distance to be with us. But it's really important that we scrutinise the bill properly to ensure that legislation that does come forward is fit for purpose. We will reflect on our discussions today and consider how we take forward the evidence we've heard today ahead of stage 2 amendments to the bill. We will now move into private session. Thank you all.